All right, I am delighted to introduce the scholars of the Borderlands Shakespeare Collectiva. BSC seeks to amplify the work of Chicanx and Indigenous artists to adapt Shakespeare to reflect the histories and lived realities of the U.S.-Mexico borderlands. They aim not only to change the way Shakespeare is taught and performed, but also to promote the socially just futures and vision in El Arte de la Frontera. The Borderlands Shakespeare Collectiva co-founders are Katherine Vomero Santos of Trinity University, Katherine Gillen of Texas A&M University in San Antonio, and Adrianna Santos of Texas A&M University in San Antonio. Together, they are editing a three-volume anthology titled The Bard and the Borderlands. Their work has been supported by funding from the Mellon Foundation, the National Endowment for the Humanities, and Folger Shakespeare Library. I'm going to pass the mic on over to them, and we're so excited that you are here. And yeah, welcome.
Thank you so much, Laura. Thank you for organizing this. Thank you also to Elizabeth Fry for organizing this. And thank you to Eric Lupfer, Director of Humanities Texas, for inviting us and agreeing to collaborate on this project with us. Kate and I have done presentations for Humanities Texas in the past, and I've always enjoyed interacting with teachers and thinking with teachers. And one of the things that is the foundation of the Borderlands Shakespeare Collectiva is teaching. So we'll pull up our slideshow and we will get started. So as you heard in Laura's description of who we are, we're a group of scholars, educators, artists, and activists who are invested in thinking about how to engage with Shakespeare in the U.S.-Mexico borderlands in ways that reflect the lived realities, cultures, and histories of this region. We use what we call decolonial and community accountable approaches, and we are attempting to amplify the world-making power of this region's languages, traditions, and ways of knowing. And Shakespeare is, in many ways, the vehicle for this work, but not where we stop. But for the purposes of our shared work tonight, we want to invite you to join the Collectiva and help us transform the way that Shakespeare is taught and performed. We came to this project in many ways because we wanted to honor our students, their lived experiences and ways of knowing. Adriana, who you'll hear from momentarily, is from San Antonio and has a PhD in Chicano-Chicano studies. But Kate and I are from the Northeast and we have PhDs in Shakespeare. So we had a lot to learn when we came to live in South Central Texas, and this project grows out of that ongoing work of learning. So if we'll go to the next slide, you can see a few things that we've been up to. This is a project that we've been working on together since 2018, when Kate and Adriana went to see a play that we'll be talking about a little bit in a little bit, called The Tragic Corrido of Romeo and Lupe, which was performed in Far Texas. So they're there in the bottom talking to the playwright and the director and some of the actors. We have worked with student actors, as you see in the photo on the bottom left. This was at West Texas A&M. And we have worked with undergraduate students, that's me and my undergrad at Trinity, and we have even been on public radio talking about this work. So I'll turn things over to Adriana to talk a little bit about the real core of our work, and that's our anthology.
Thank you, Katie. Sorry, I wanted to show the beautiful cover as I was speaking about it. Our anthology, The Bard in the Borderlands, an anthology of Shakespeare appropriations and La Frontera, was published in March of 2023, and it includes six multilingual adaptations of Shakespeare works. This first volume is focusing on adaptations, appropriations of Romeo and Juliet and Hamlet, those being the two most performed and frequently taught of Shakespeare's works. We are also anticipating volume two in March of 2024, and then volume 3 in March of 2025. So we're very excited to bring that to you as well. Each of the plays also includes a critical introduction, but I will turn it over to, and they focus on Borderlands Shakespeare, which is itself a hybrid project, blending many different art forms and genres and myths, including both Chicanx and Indigenous genres. These works are acknowledging Shakespeare's role as a symbol of power, of whiteness, but also showing how communities, local artists, theaters are empowered by appropriating these works in order to call attention to local issues. As we write in our introduction to the book, Borderlands Shakespeare appropriations emphasize the value, beauty, and restorative power of Indigenous and Chicanx languages, genres, mythologies, and rituals, providing a counterpoint to the Western epistemologies conveyed in their source texts.
As Katie mentioned, teaching is really at the core of the work of the Borderlands Shakespeare Colectiva and was one of the primary motivations for the anthology that we created. And one more quick shout out to Humanities Texas. In 2018, Adrianna and I organized what was one of our earliest kind of activities of the Colectiva, which was a conference here at Texas A&M San Antonio, which was funded by Humanities Texas. And at it, many teachers came and discussed their interest in teaching texts that engaged with Shakespeare and Borderlands contexts. And many people at that event and in other, which Katie was also at, Katie presented at as well, asked us about how they could access some of these plays. And at that point, we actually didn't know about too many of the plays, but the ones we did know about, we only had in PDF form, and we didn't have permission yet from the playwrights to share them. So as we heard from more and more teachers, we really saw how hungry people were for culturally relevant ways of teaching Shakespeare and also for incorporating Chicanx and Indigenous work into classrooms, English language classrooms, and other classrooms that they were teaching in. And so we got really excited about that. And we also really started teaching this work ourselves and saw how powerfully it resonated with students. So a couple reasons why you might consider teaching either the Borderlands Shakespeare plays themselves or using excerpts from them in conjunction with other Shakespeare works that you might be teaching are, there are many reasons. And one of them is that doing so offers various points of access, allowing students to bring themselves and their knowledge to Shakespeare's work. Teaching Borderlands Shakespeare plays has become really central to my efforts to engage with culturally sustaining approaches to Shakespeare. Often students are asked to kind of leave their identities at the door, especially when analyzing canonical works of literature like Shakespeare, and Borderlands Shakespeare invites the ways of knowing that arise from Borderlands communities into the classroom. And it also invites students from other backgrounds to bring their own cultures and languages to bear on the material that we're studying in classes. Borderlands Shakespeare plays also initiate conversations about the complex mixture of languages that we see in the Borderlands, Englishes, Spanishes, Spanglishes, and Indigenous languages. And this is also a helpful way of engaging with the language in Shakespeare's plays, which is also often hybrid and stems from many national backgrounds. Borderlands Shakespeare plays also help us consider contemporary resonances of Shakespeare. Why are we studying Shakespeare now? What do Shakespeare's plays mean to us? And differences among historical periods and geographical regions. And because they are so creative and generative, Borderlands Shakespeare plays invite creative responses to Shakespeare that encourage students to see his works as dynamic rather than static and fixed in time.
I just want to take a minute to say that I'm so excited to see so many folks from the Valley joining us. I think you'll really love the play that we're going to talk about. Welcome to everybody. Thank you for telling us where you're visiting us from and joining us from. So we thought we would outline some approaches to teaching these plays, or as Kate said, teaching with these plays. If you're teaching Shakespeare, you might incorporate some of these plays into your lesson plans. And depending on the level or context in which you're teaching, you will immediately start to identify how this might align with the goals and standards that you are trying to meet with your students. But some approaches might include comparing the themes in Shakespeare with Borderlands adaptations by looking at the scenes or the full plays, asking your students what changes in Borderlands contexts, what becomes clearer or deeper as a result. What we've found in our teaching is that these adaptations really light Shakespeare up in a new way if students are allowed to enter the text through stories and art forms that they know, bringing Shakespeare kind of closer in many ways. Analyzing language, of course, is a big part of what we do as English and language arts teachers or as drama teachers. We're always trying to ask ourselves and our students, what does Shakespeare's text mean? But what might it mean if we translate it or adapt it? What do students think about hearing or themselves reproducing Shakespeare in Spanish or Spanglish? How might those words resonate in new ways for them? You could, with your students, explore Borderlands cultures, genres, geographies, and histories, and think about how those relate to Shakespeare's early modern English contexts. We'll share in a little bit the ways in which poetic forms of the Borderlands resonate with Shakespeare's poetic forms. They're not so far apart as they might at first seem to our students, or we can explore the fact that Shakespeare's plays were being written at the very same time that the Spanish were colonizing this region. So what happens if we think about the early modern period as central to understanding the Borderlands? And then finally, and this has been one of the most exciting things for us, is to invite students to create their own adaptations, appropriations, translations, and remixes. If students have examples of creative adaptations and appropriations of Shakespeare, they often feel empowered to be able to do that work themselves.
I also just wanted to give a quick shout out to Araceli Manriquez, who is here, who has been helping us develop lesson plans as well, which should be available to you all soon. We've been working with Tony Diaz and the Nuestra Palabra organization to make the anthology available in schools and also to make the lesson plans available. And that has been funded by a grant from Joaquin Castro's office. And so Araceli is a wonderful expert, and I'm so glad that she's here with us as well as we work through some exercises and activities this evening.
To follow up on that, ACMRS Press is committed to publishing open access works. And so this book is available to buy as both a paperback and a hardcover at an affordable price. However, it is free and available to all to read. And so that makes it even more accessible for teachers and for students and anyone who wants to have access to the book. So as I mentioned before, in this first volume, there are six distinct unique, beautifully written plays, but today we're just going to focus on two. So I will introduce the first. It is a Romeo and Juliet appropriation called The Language of Flowers, written by Edith Villarreal. It premiered in California at California State University, Los Angeles in 1991, originally titled R&J. It was conceived in a collaborative effort with playwright Jose Cruz Gonzalez, and shows not an ethnic divide between Romeo and Juliet, but rather a conflict between Mexican Americans and working class undocumented Mexicans and Mexican Americans. And the entire story is framed through Dia de los Muertos. It takes place the few days in which that tradition is being celebrated, and therefore emphasizes the Nahuatl language and also Mexica belief systems. Ultimately, because Romeo dies crossing the border as well, it depicts the violence of the militarized border and how U.S. immigration policies affect Romeo and Juliet's romance and untimely deaths.
Another play that we would like to focus on today is Ceres Jaime Magaña's The Tragic Corrido of Romeo and Lupe. And we were lucky enough to see this play produced in FAR Texas, where it was first produced. And we were also lucky enough to see students do a staged reading of it in West Texas at West Texas A&M. You saw the picture earlier. It's an amazing, engaging, innovative play. It is set in the Rio Grande Valley and explores issues of colonialism, environmental destruction, labor exploitation, and linguistic and cultural hybridity. Similar to The Language of Flowers, it's engaged with and exploring these intra-ethnic conflicts. Romeo's mixed race family owns the Campbell Irrigation Company, and so they're kind of owners, and they're in conflict with Lupe's Mexican American family, who primarily works in the fields. And in this play, Romeo and Lupe meet at a protest, and that sets the stage for their relationship and their attempts to bridge these divides. There's a lot of engagement with language and translation in the play, which has dialogue in Spanish, English, and Spanglish. And as we'll discuss more in a minute, the play employs multiple genres, including the corrido, rap, actos, and other forms as well, including kind of like protest chants and things like that. And the play really centers religious imagery from Mexican, American, and Indigenous traditions. And Lupe's name in particular, and her whole character, resonates with the figure of La Virgen de Guadalupe. And Lupe sees herself as a figure that's kind of joining Indigenous and European traditions in a way that's associated with La Virgen. And so now we'll provide some context as well for these plays as we seek to analyze some moments in them both.
Romeo and Lupe is an excellent example of the influence of teatro or teatro campesino on this tradition of borderland Shakespeare that we are identifying. Teatro was born out of the United Farm Workers Union as El Teatro Campesino, founded by Luis Valdez, and is associated with the movement for farm workers' rights, as well as the Chicano movement for civil rights, and other contemporary activist aims continue to remain central to teatro. Teatro Campesino is still operating and doing good work in our communities. It is invested in using theater as a tool for collective liberation and embraces an aesthetic called rascuachismo, which basically means to make do with what you've got, to repurpose things, and to infuse a working class aesthetic into an artistic sensibility.
So the other context that we want to highlight in thinking about the traditions that Borderland Shakespeare is drawing on is that of the corrido, which you heard in the title of Ceres Magaña's play. But in both Romeo and Juliet plays that we're going to be talking about, as well as in other Borderlands Shakespeare adaptations, the playwrights replace the figure of Shakespeare's chorus or other kind of narrative figures with a corridista or a singer of corridos. Many of you are probably familiar with the genre of the corrido, and your students are probably familiar with this genre. but it's a hybrid Mexican song form that's adapted from European narrative ballads and commonly featured in teatro and the plays that Adriana was just talking about. It's a song form that's grounded in oral storytelling and community-based performance. It carries the history of the people, and it tells the stories of both heroes and everyday folks, which frankly sounds a lot like a Shakespeare play. So I think you can start to see the ways in which these playwrights were recognizing in Shakespeare and in teatro the opportunity to bring the corrido into their plays. And if it's possible, I wanted to just play a corrido.
La Julieta y el Romeo, los dos hijos de familia, con poder y con dinero.
We can pause there. Thank you. I could have played any number of corridos, but I thought that this one really illustrated what the genre does to tell a story about well-known figures using European song forms as adapted by Mexican and Mexican-American communities. And we can share with you some of these resources. There was recently a PBS episode on border ballads that took place here in San Antonio, and the Kennedy Center has a lesson plan on corridos as well.
And what we wanted to do now is read the opening chorus or corrido from the three plays that we're talking about today and give you all a chance together to do some analysis and to think about how you might use this exercise in your own classrooms. So I'll start us off with the Shakespeare, which I'm sure you're very familiar with. So that play, of course, starts off with a chorus who says, "Two households, both alike in dignity, in fair Verona, where we lay our scene, from ancient grudge break to new mutiny, where civil blood makes civil hands unclean. From forth the fatal loins of these two foes, a pair of star-crossed lovers take their life, whose misadventured, piteous overthrows doth with their death bury their parents' strife. The fearful passage of their death-marked love and the continuance of their parents' rage, which but their children's end not could remove, is now the 2 hours traffic of our stage, the which, if you with patient ears attend, what here shall miss, our toil shall strive to mend." And now Adriana will read from The Language of Flowers.
I wish I could sing this to you because it was actually sung as a corrido in the performance, but we were unable to get the rights to the music because you may recognize the famous musician who wrote the music for The Language of Flowers before Coco fame, Germaine Franco, who I think also wrote the music for, what was the one that just came out last
Encanto.
Year?
Encanto.
Encanto. So... Nuestro corrido begins in this city, Los Angeles, also known as LA. Una ciudad, a very big city, with mucha gente de muchos lugares arriving here each day to live in LA. Nicaraguenses y salvadoreños, guatemaltecos, all fleeing from war. Pobres cubanos, también mexicanos, searching for work for themselves, bringing their families here to stay, right here in LA. But nuestro corrido is not about war. Nuestro corrido is all about love. Juliet, an American, met Romeo, a poor Mexican. Their love started boiling. They were meant for each other. It was written that way. But LA is not for loving. LA is not for love. LA is not for dreaming, and LA is not for luck. Now I've started this corrido, but now I'll end my song. Romeo and Julieta should tell their own, to tell their story on their own.
And now Katie will read to us from the tragic corrido.
Yes, and I believe Laura just put this in the chat, but the file where you can read along is also available in the Google Classroom. So again, we would invite you to imagine this being sung rather than read as a poem. We talked about someday commissioning recordings of these corridos as teaching tools. No le digas no al amor. No hagas tanto coraje. Este es mi mensaje. Don't say no to love. Here in the Magic Valley, in the Republic of Texas, on these fertile lands of opportunity, covered in blood and strife, blooms a forbidden love. No le digas no al amor. No hagas tanto coraje. Este es mi mensaje. Don't say no to love. Sabes de la antigua discordia aquí en el Valle Mágico. La gente se levanta en protesta contra los visionarios. No le digas no al amor. No hagas tanto coraje. Este es mi mensaje. Don't say no to love. Only love can free a soul. Take heed of this true story. Don't say no to love.
Now, we would like to invite you all to share some of your impressions of these passages that open the plays, and you're welcome to use the chat or welcome to raise your hand and we will call on you. But we're wondering why you think Villarreal and Magaña started their plays with corridos and what work these opening songs do. How are they similar to or different from Shakespeare's opening chorus? And also, how might you approach teaching the chorus and the corridos to your students? Or what questions do you have for us about the ways these are working and how we might teach them? Yeah, we can even maybe, well, we'll leave that up there, but I was thinking, I don't know if we want to close the slideshow in a minute too, just so we can see everybody as you think about this. And we can also maybe, Adrianna, do you want to move it back one just to show the songs one more time? And you have the documents as well.
You can even put things in the chat, but please feel free to just unmute and or raise your hand. Yeah, Jennifer.
It's scary to be the first person to talk. I was thinking about, because we also do the Odyssey with freshmen, and they have that chorus, you know, that. And I was thinking about just the word in general, the etymology of chorus is a dance, right? We could get choreography from that and music and things like that. And I never thought of it this way, but it makes perfect sense to have a song at the beginning of to tell us as a prologue of what is going to happen.
That's great. And that resonates with what Nina has said in the chat, right? That this figure is setting the stage. Is it a kind of narrator figure who's going to guide us? I think Giovanni, sorry, Kate, I don't mean to take over as moderator. No.
Yeah, maybe Giovanni, would you like to share your ideas?
Yeah, I was just going to say really quickly, so like the sonnet is a very highly traditional way to format a feeling or experience. And kind of in the same way, the corrido is a very traditional way to format and to give context to this city, this setting. So it's just kind of like picking up on, we're not following this tradition, we're following this particular tradition.
Yeah, I think that's a really valuable point, right? Situating within that traditional space and thinking about which traditions we're engaging with here. That's a really valuable point. Thank you. Vanessa.
Hi. So I think for me, the one like looking at it side by side with the flowers, sorry, I was like, I blanked the language of flowers, thank you. But like looking at those two in comparison, I think one of the things that I always do when I teach Romeo and Juliet is looking at like the modern translation of the text, like whether it's the No Fear Shakespeare or something, to make it a little more accessible. And so this kind of takes that even a step further, where it's making it like culturally relevant, and it's making it something that the students can connect to and find those moments of like, okay, we're setting the stage, we're talking about it, we're, you know, viewing this in our classroom, because we're not necessarily, it's an English classroom, so we're not acting it out. So how are we setting the stage and looking at these characters? And I always tell them, like, Shakespeare spoils the ending right from the beginning. Like, he tells you in the chorus what's going to happen, and like, they're dead, and like, it is what it is. So how do we get there? And I think, like, having the corrido, it's like this, it's the same outline, it's the same structure. But like, if they know how the structure of the songs work, they know how the structure of these traditional formats work, then they understand, like, we already know where it's going. And we can have that kind of like cultural background in our mind of like, we know these stories. This is nothing new. We've seen them. We understand them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And what you're interested in is sort of how it's going to play out, right? Like, what's going to be new about the way that it's dramatized in that way. I also like your point about, yeah, thinking about how to like emphasize the embodied nature of it, especially when it's in a literature or English-based classroom. And I like the point earlier about the etymology of chorus. Adriana and I were actually looking up the etymology of corrido yesterday when we were talking about this, which comes from the verb to run, right? Like correr or like correre in Latin. And so thinking about those like related but not precisely, you know, identical etymologies, which are so like embodied and connect us to this embodied performance tradition to help kind of situate students. So yeah, I love what you all are coming up with. Other comments people had or questions, maybe in the chat. Okay, yes, in the chat. So let's see. Nina is saying, right away, I think about how this is their experience. Like so many, like Shakespeare sets the scene, so do they. Yeah, so they're definitely like setting the scene, right? And they're so descriptive in terms of like, who's there? What is the city like, right? In the language of flowers. And also in terms of like the love in the Magic Valley, right? The strife, that setting, they're definitely setting the scene and situating us. Yes. Engaging way to set the context. Yes, the traditions. Seeing students making connections, absolutely. Yeah, the connection to the Greek chorus.
Mm-hmm. Something else that I wanted to just add is what they do with the ancient grudge, right? The students are always like, well, what could this feud really be about? But in the case of both, and especially the tragic corrido, they let us know that that ancient grudge is not really senseless at all, right? It's rooted in these colonial histories, these histories of migration. And so it's situating Romeo and Juliet within a kind of heightened political context that does what the corrido does, which is to kind of carry that history forward.
And I think in Shakespeare's play, part of the point, right, is that there's something about this city that's like sort of problematic. It's like there are images of the plague. Obviously, there's sort of a, I don't know, corruption, and there's a senseless feud that's affecting everybody's lives, but nobody really knows why. Whereas in these other plays, like, it's really clear, right? This LA is not for loving, LA is not for luck, and it becomes like very clear, like, what is wrong with this city, the space, and the colonial histories that are shaping that. Yeah, I love Araceli's point too, just about the way corridos become a way of storytelling, right? And to really get students to think about storytelling and how we tell stories and just the pedagogical potential in that for all kinds of assignments.
And the tragic corrido. Oh, I'd like to. Go ahead.
I was going to pick up on Araceli's point and point especially to corridos as having a consejo or a message, a certain type of moral, that these art forms are not just for telling stories, but also for teaching how to behave. Mm-hmm. The moral tales, sort of telling us how we should and should not act, and what should be important to us, explaining the values of a society. And so I think it's really interesting how you have Shakespeare's chorus sort of talking to you in terms of like a summary, whereas these are more involving the relationships between the people and the giving the opportunity to think about what is the moral behind this, or what can we learn from this?
I also really appreciate that the message in this corrido that we're looking at from the tragic corrido is don't say no to love, right? There's definitely an embrace from the beginning of Romeo and Juliet's love, and we're not supposed to be sort of critical of it, and we're really supposed to root for them throughout. Whereas I feel like in Shakespeare, there's always this question, like, is this a good idea? Like, what exactly are they doing? And so here, I think we're really supposed to be on board, and it sets it up more to be this romantic story. Mm-hmm.
One final practical note that I observed just in getting ready for this workshop is that this corrido in Magaña's play is so beautifully constructed because it translates itself. So if you have a classroom with mixed language learners, there's an opportunity to talk about how the Spanish language is translated by the English and vice versa, to kind of bring everybody in and maybe even to talk about the differences between the words. So it is truly a hybrid text in that way.
I really appreciate Ali's point in the chat as well about that, and the way that it kind of attends or points out that Elizabethan English is also kind of a hybrid language, right? And sort of having that opportunity to think about the history of the English language and its Germanic roots as well as the French roots, and the fact that it's being like taken from, you know, an Italian story and being repackaged. So really, I think students often think of Shakespeare's English as somehow pure or something like that, and it's not. And so thinking about hybridity of language and the validity of multiple language practices is really important. Are there final comments on this before we move on? Or any thoughts about how you would teach this? Yeah, Stephanie.
Yeah, so this is going to be my first year teaching Hamlet. This is my second year teaching. So I was really excited to see this this anthology. All I keep thinking is about like how my students are going to love it. And they're going to like, if I incorporate it, they're just going to love it. Because I teach, you know, in the Valley. I teach in the Rio Grande Valley. So starting it off with a corrido is going to be great. It reminds me of like Ansaldúa, how she started Borderlands with Tigres del Norte lyrics. It just shows students and our readers that anything is possible. You can literally write in Spanglish. You can start off with corridos. You can start off with music. And like, it's possible even in academic writing. I think it's so powerful. And I'm so glad, I just want to say like that y'all are doing this work. I mean, it makes me as a teacher and as a person living in these borderlands, it makes me so happy.
That's so wonderful to hear. We'll be excited to hear about your experiences. And we do have a bilingual Hamlet by Tara Moses, which is part of the anthology, which is also set within the framework of Dia de los Muertos. So I think there's a lot going on there with like the ghosts and rethinking death as not being something final, but thinking about death as part of life. So I'll be excited to hear from you. Yeah, Araceli.
So great to see everybody, and I'm really glad so many people are here learning from y'all's wonderful works that y'all put together. I think one of my favorite things I've done in my Mexican American Studies class is just write corridos, like have the kids pick a like social issue topic, or it could be a reflection on a piece of literature they just read. And like, you just give them a very basic template, and you can find one online, you can make it yourself. And just that basic like intro, what's the story, what's the lesson that's learned in a farewell. And I have been blown away with like the corridos that they have written themselves. Again, especially about things like, you know, I've had corridos written about Black Lives Matter, or, you know, whatever issue that we're talking about that day. And so that's really, yeah, that's been a really awesome thing to see the students do and develop their own creative writing skills with.
Such an amazing assignment. Yeah, thank you for sharing that.
I mentioned this in the chat, but I can share with the group via Humanities Texas in the Google Classroom that there are two poems that reimagine the to be or not to be soliloquy as poems about being a Borderlands subject or a person who lives in the Borderlands. One is by Guillermo Gomez Peña, the Mexican performance artist, and the other is a poem called To Be a Pocha or Not to Be by Iris de Anda. And that one really resonates with students. I'm thinking about Hamlet's dilemma as the dilemma of somebody who is between languages, between cultures, cut off in some ways from both.
Mm-hmm. I really wanted to highlight as well Jeffrey's comment in the chat about how teaching these plays can allow Spanish speakers to be authorities in spaces, especially when you have, you know, white teachers, like, you know, like myself, who are not fluent Spanish speakers, like thinking about like how that's decentering knowledge and really inviting students to be experts in the classroom. Thank you for that point.
For this next activity, please refer to the Google Classroom where there's a document containing the balcony scenes from Romeo and Juliet, The Language of Flowers, and The Tragic Corrido. One second. I guess I'll leave it like this for a minute. Okay, so what we're going to do here is to compare, first read and then compare the balcony scenes. You may be familiar with the Romeo and Juliet source material because it's been immortalized in so many films and television, from, you know, Romeo and Juliet to the Baz Luhrmann Romeo plus Juliet with Leonardo DiCaprio. But I am going to play you a short clip of that balcony scene, probably the most famous from the 1970s. And then since you have the text for Language of Flowers and Romeo and Lupe, we're going to put you in some small groups to talk about how they're similar or different, to analyze the contexts that are arising from them, and maybe to sketch out a possible lesson plan. So I will play this clip just so that we can all be on the same page of what is the traditional version of this balcony scene.
But soft. What light through yonder window breaks? My lady. Oh, it is my love. Oh, that she knew she were. She speaks, yet she says nothing. What of that? Her eye discourses. I will answer it. I am too bold. 'Tis not to me she speaks. Two of the fairest stars in all the heavens, having some business, to entreat her eyes to twinkle in their spheres till they return. See how she leans her cheek upon her hand. Oh, that I were a glove upon that hand, that I might touch that cheek.
Oh, me.
She speaks. Oh, speak again, bright angel.
Oh, Romeo, Romeo. Wherefore art thou, Romeo? Deny thy father, and refuse thy name. Or if thou wilt not, be but sworn, my love, and I'll no longer be a Capulet.
Shall I hear more, or shall I speak of
this? 'Tis but thy name that is my enemy. Thou art thyself, though, not a Montague. What is Montague? It is nor hand, nor foot, nor arm, nor face, nor any other part belonging to a man. Oh, be some other name. What's in a name? Thy which you call a rose. By any other name would smell as sweet. So Romeo would, were he not Romeo called, retain that dear perfection which he owes without that title. Romeo, doff thy name, and for that name which is no part of thee, take all myself.
I take thee at thy word. Call me but love and I'll be new baptized. Henceforth, I never will be Romeo.
Okay, apologies, I misspoke. The Zeffirelli version came out in 1968. So if you would like to look that up, you'd be able to find it. So I will share again some of the questions that we have ready for you all to consider in your small groups, in your breakout rooms. We'll leave about 20 minutes for you all to confer. We'll also be available when you're in the groups. If you want to ask for help, there should be a button that you can press on the Zoom and one of us will pop in there and give some guidance. But hopefully there will be some good discussion, some generative conversation going on about what you noticed about these balcony scenes. Hello.
Welcome back.
Thanks for sticking it out. I hope that you had a good conversation. The Google Doc is filling up, so we'll have lots of things to talk about, I'm sure. I'm going to go ahead and share the screen one more time so we can get back to our questions. And I guess we'll open it up. Would anybody like to maybe speak to their own experience or perhaps share for their group and other people can jump in? What did you notice about each of the scenes? How would you approach teaching them to your students? And what other resources or activities would be useful to this lesson? Please feel free to unmute yourself, raise your hand, or type in the chat.
One of the things that our group kind of talked about was that I apologize for my Spanish, but the scene from the tragic corrido felt like it still maintained a lot of the kind of the Shakespearean language, some direct lines, but also tried to maintain some of his stylistic choices, right, in terms of writing. And I was thinking a lot about that and then the difference with the language of flowers, which felt like a much more kind of reader-friendly, student-friendly version of an adaptation, right? And I was thinking, you know, how I may use the tragic corrido, but I was actually thinking about sending some of those things to our ESL and our sheltered teachers as well, who struggle to introduce students to Shakespeare. And maybe this could be a great entryway for those things. I just kind of noticed that the first one was a little more, tried to keep some of that Shakespearean flavor, while the second one seemed a little less concerned with that and more with just the story and storytelling.
I really appreciate you thinking like a teacher and, you know, who can I distribute this to? Who else can benefit from this, from these resources? So thank you for that. And that's great. Yeah, just noticing the different ways that language is used and how, quote unquote, true to the text they stay. That's really interesting. Anybody else want to jump in? Colleen?
I'm sorry, it's taken me a little time to kind of process things. And I took a lot of time to read and was just listening to what people were saying in our group. And there were some really cool things. And somebody mentioned, and I have this in my classroom, we have a lot of students who are like all they speak is Spanish. They're brand new English speakers. And then I've got some in between, and then I've got some all English speakers that don't speak a word of Spanish. And so I'm thinking this would be a really cool kind of differentiation activity, because somebody in our group mentioned how hard would that, some of the correo and the other one be for people who were not native Spanish speakers. Why couldn't you like use it as a differentiation break apart and let the students teach? Let your full English speakers tackle the Shakespeare one, and they teach the full Shakespeare one, and my Spanish speakers teach the correo, and we talk about themes, but they each have to sort of approach it and incorporate their language and do their exploration, almost like a PBL kind of thing, that they could tackle each of those with, and then use their language expertise as the platform, the entryway into teaching their lesson. I don't know, I'm just thinking about using it as differentiation based off some things people said in my group.
Thank you so much for sharing that, Colleen. Yep, project-based learning has some really great results in terms of students being able to take initiative and take agency over what they're learning. So it sounds like that would work really well in a context where you have students coming from different linguistic backgrounds. Thank you. Anyone else? I can't see the chat. So Kate or Katie, would you like to maybe call on someone from the chat or read some of the insights from the Google Doc, perhaps?
I was thinking from the Google Doc, I appreciated some of the points people were raising about the politics of language and the language of flowers in particular, and thinking about like why some people speak Spanish and other people don't speak Spanish, and the cultural, you know, dynamics, political dynamics that have led to that. So I think it can really be helpful in the kind of context you're talking about, as well as others, for kind of developing that critical language literacy around these questions of like language and culture and power. So I really liked what Group 4 and maybe Group 6 we're talking about there.
Yeah, I'd also like to highlight what Group 3 was writing about with regard to a lesson plan, reversing it and starting with these texts and then going back to the Shakespeare. I think that would be a really powerful approach, because as we were saying earlier, right, this might be a point of access that helps to dispel some of that Shakespeare that people have. If they can approach it from a text that they can more easily relate to or comprehend, then they can start to understand not just what Shakespeare's text means, but to understand Shakespeare as an artist, and an artist who is sort of part of a web of creators of stories. So I love that reverse approach. And it also kind of destabilizes the hierarchy, right? It's not that Shakespeare's hard and these are easier, or Shakespeare came first and these came later, right? But that they might teach us new things about Shakespeare.
Yes. Thank you so much for sharing that, Katie. I get to cheat and not teach Shakespeare at all, because I teach Mexican American studies. So I really love that approach, coming at it from different perspectives and with everyone on even playing fields, so to speak. Other insights?
Was that Vanessa's point? Is that why Jennifer was giving her props?
Vanessa, is that your hand?
Yeah, sorry. Yeah, and thank you, Jennifer. Sorry. So, yeah, I was in Group 3, and that's what we were talking about. But I was kind of looking back at, and then I just closed it. Of course I did. But looking at the language of flowers, we were kind of talking about that it's this much more like modern, really fast approach to this idea of romance. And that, like, rather than Romeo kind of being like off to the side and like looking at, you know, Julieta and kind of like being a little bit of, as my students would say, a creep, like just kind of creeping off to the side, that it's like this really direct, like he goes up and they kiss and it's like this immediate thing. And so the immediacy of that, the contemporary like nature of that, and that kind of like approach to romance and love is just something that I think would be interesting for them to like grasp and think about, like in a way of like this story. And then the other things that the story introduces, this idea of like the colorism, which is, you know, something that I don't think we, speaking as like an Anglo teacher, like it's not something that I normally had thought about until I started teaching in the Borderlands, of this idea that colorism is, and has been and is still a problem in like Mexican American culture and in Mexican culture, and like different, you know, skin tones and how that impacts it, as well as like class issues. And I think rather than this really, and I know you guys brought up this point, but this really ambiguous nature of the feud between the Montagues and the Capulets in Romeo and Juliet, this really like defined, this is what it's about. Like, this is what the issue is. This is where we get into the heart of like, how are some of these feuds, like what are some of these potential feuds? And I think then that leads into this conversation with Romeo and Juliet and going back into the Shakespearean text of like, okay, we don't know what the feud was. It's never explained. Shakespeare leaves it really open, which is, by the way, part of the reason why this is so lasting and enduring, is because we can overlay all these other things on it. So what do we understand to be like some of the potential things that happen? Using the language of flowers as like a frame, they talk about colorism. They talk about classism. What else can we talk about that could be the reason why these families are in feud and why there's so much conflict here that leads to these tragic endings? And how do we understand that? So I think it's like starting with something that you can make concrete, then going back to, gotta love Shakespeare, but he is a little abstract at times, going back into those more abstract things and kind of fleshing it out from there and applying other theoretical frameworks is awesome. It leads it open to a lot of like really interesting potential conversations. So
thank you, Vanessa, for exploring some of that potential. So interesting. I'm gonna call on Jose as our last contributor for this section because we are running out of time. Jose.
Thank you. I just had something quick because taking from the idea of corridos, I work at a high school, like probably a lot of high schools here. I'm here in the close to the border in South Texas, McAllen, Edinburgh, and give an idea. The majority of students, I would say, like corridos. They drive in on those that drive vehicle. They come in listening to corridos. So I know I've used those for other lessons, and I have unique experience. I've been able to have been a teacher of Spanish classes and English classes, currently still teaching English. And we'll be looking at Macbeth and like to bring another poetry. And I have just been using even different corridos for other types of lessons. So especially this is a wonderful idea from the works that you showed us, like the corrido and Romeo and Lupe. And yeah, I wasn't even, I had heard, but I didn't know that much. And it's here in our backyard. And that's something we're trying. It's the next idea that you share with us. We're close to the border, but it's about what we can take advantage that it's right here and part of our students' culture.
Thank you. Thank you all so much for sharing. Read Katie's comment in the chat. It's amazing. While I share the screen, that will lead you to a survey. We would love to hear more from you. About what would be helpful for you in the classroom. What resources do you want to see? We would love to keep you updated with the resources that we have coming down the line. So I'll turn it over to Katie.
Thank you. I've lost track in trying to see everybody. I lost track of Adriana's shared screen. But on this form, which I shared also in the chat, so you don't have to scan the QR unless you want to, we really would just love to hear more from you about what kinds of lesson plans you would need, whether you'd like things like interviews with the playwrights. Would you like digitized material? Sometimes these posters from the plays are really beautiful. Filmed performances of scenes or of whole plays, or more opportunities to see live performance. Those are some things that we could think of, but you certainly will have other ideas of your own. And we would just love to hear what questions you still have You know, no question is too small. And finally, if you would like to stay in touch with us, we'd be really happy to have your email, and we'll include you on any kind of events and lesson plans that we send out.